Once again, thanks for coming, man. I'm really counting on you to see if you can dig up some clues. You up to the task?
Don't worry, pal. Nothing ever gets by the great detective Gumshoe. I'll discover what's going on around here, don't you worry.
Perfect. And I've already informed the others. Your cover is a safety inspector, so you don't have to worry about being caught in any restricted areas.
Can't the ship watch us, like, all the time? Like, right now, even?
Nah, his audio and video monitoring is disabled in my quarters. He's blind to everything in this room, so you're good to go.
Ah, good plan. Okay, pal, I'll begin my investigation immediately.
Alright, now that that's settled, let's take a look at the first book in the Daring Do series, The Marked Thief of Marapore. We begin with a prologue where a mysterious stallion is lamenting over his scarred flank, all the while plotting his thievery on the city of Marapore. We then cut to our Pegasus heroine returning home from her previous adventure. Upon her return home, a cloaked golden stallion is stalking around her home, informing her that Marapore is in danger and needs her help, and leaves a rare book providing clues for Daring. Continuity-wise, the story takes place after Daring Don't as she mentions the Elements of Harmony and the Rings of Scorchero event. A nice nod to the main series. She finds a marked chapter about the flanker artifacts, and we get our Temple of Doom reference. The mystical relics consist of a sword, staff, and arrow, and are used to protect the tri-corner villages of Marapore, Lusitano, and Ponipei from the nearby volcano of Mount Vehuvius, due to erupt soon. But the artifacts combined can also be used to heal any mortal injury, but has a single use, and requires a captive audience and a golden pedagogue, which are elements of the Vehuvius Hex. We haven't even started the adventure, and already the book entices you with its world-building mysticism and mystery. It's definitely one of the book's strongest elements. So Daring heads off still weary from her previous adventure and stays at the Gideon Inn, where it seems the mysterious gold pulling from earlier also stayed, in room number 3 no less, and left it trashed. The reasoning behind this, however, is never followed up on. However, she finds a parchment and a bottle of hide ointment. I'll come back to this later. She uses the ointment on herself before departing and heads to Marapore. We get an interesting exposition dump from the hotel owner about the three villages, and how they're primarily agricultural cities, with Marapore being loom masters with their distinctive cloaks. Speaking of cloaks, Daring suddenly reveals that she has one similar to their village to blend in, but gets found out almost immediately. Why so much emphasis on building up on disguising herself if you're just gonna let her get caught 2 minutes later? That kind of plot convenience and exposition are a few technical errors I noticed in a couple areas in the story. However, she's welcomed into the village, heralded as a prophesied Pegasus and protector of the Arrow Relic, in lieu of their previous protector Golden Rule being kidnapped. She learns more about the situation from our short round of the story, Tater Tot, who passes on the knowledge he learned from Golden Rule, telling her that the thief is actually Mojo, who was once the stalwart stallion of Naples, who originally gifted the three artifacts to the villages, and that GR is the golden pedagogue from the Vehuvius Hex prophecy. The cult also recognizes the parchment Daring retrieved in another book and completes the puzzle, revealing Morse code used on a cave entrance. That night, Mojo steals the artifact, with Daring following in tow. In Retrieval of the Arrow, we see his magic is weak due to his scarred cutie mark. It's an interesting concept, similar to the Switch Destiny situation from Magical Mystery Cure, where we see that cutie marks can have adverse effects on a pony's magic when damaged. Tater Tot gets captured, being too tenacious for his own good, and the two flee back to his lair with Daring behind them. Gaining entrance to the cave, Daring is captured by the village's possessed animals, a realized premonition that Daring received back at the inn. As far as Mojo's character is concerned, he's pretty much a cliched, over-the-top, monologuing villain, though what makes him stand out is the fact that he now, out of every other villain in MLP, is probably the most evil. Why? Take every other villain in MLP. Sure, they want to conquer Equestria, but they never want to kill, you know, for the obvious reason. Yet, this guy is willing to let three whole villages, letting all those innocent lives be killed by a volcanic eruption, just so he can heal his cutie mark and get his power back. That is evil. He's one of those villains that you just want to die. But as interesting as that character type is, it feels out of place in the MLP universe with that level of unremorseful character running about. Anyway, Mojo tells Daring that she is the Golden Pegasus with a volcano cutie mark, a lie told by GR to fulfill the prophecy. Daring's cutie mark suddenly disappears due to the ointment, and Mojo is legitimately pissed, possessing the wrong Pegasus. Here is where the climax falls apart and things don't make sense. GR tells Daring that he is actually the golden pedagogue of the prophecy and that he left clues for her at the inn, which was a horrible plan. The original book he left for Daring at the house never indicated that more clues could be found at the inn, thus she would have never gotten the ointment or, more importantly, the code to get into his lair. He banked everything on the off chance that she would stop at that specific inn. And despite all this, Mojo does the ritual anyway, knowing he doesn't have the right golden Pegasus. We know that all the elements of the prophecy are here, but he just says, screw it, and tries anyway. Basically saying that Golden Rule and Daring's entire role in this story is entirely pointless. Then we come to the biggest problem I have, which is Mojo's face turn. The two confronted each other, and Daring mentions that she can contend with him just like Aoi Zotal, who then reveals that he's the cause of his deformed cutie mark after wanting to leave his clan and return back to the Royal Navy. Daring pleads with Mojo to stop the ritual, since he's in a vulnerable state, to return the weapons. And he does.
How the hell can you be so smart and so stupid at the same time, mate?
It's a gift.
Which makes no sense. He and Daring now share a common enemy. So what? His motivation for this whole thing was healing his cutie mark. That motivation hasn't changed. He's been planning this for weeks, again willing to sacrifice the lives of all the nearby villages, doing a decent amount of prep work, yet tosses all his work aside just because Daring knows how he's Zodal. I have no words to describe this contrived redemption plot. Moving on, Daring returns the artifacts to each of the towns just as the volcano erupts and produces a shield over the towns protecting them. Afterwards, Daring returns to Mojo with prospects of healing him with an artifact that she was previously searching for, but only after repenting his crimes. However, he's way beyond any redemption and sympathy at this point. Later on, Golden Rule gives Daring Do a rare book on flowers as a parting gift, hinting at something called the Eternal Flower, which is the subject for the next book, ending our adventure. Despite the weird and contrived climax and some technical writing errors, I can't say I didn't enjoy the story. It had enough mystery to keep you intrigued where the adventure goes next. Daring is a fun character, adventurous, sarcastic, brash, but humble. World building with various locations and artifacts, and the story as a whole is written with great detail and vivid imagery. Plus, it's already got me interested to read the next adventure with its cliffhanger ending. So I'll check out that book in the future. Till next time, MC out.